given to me by Sam to maybe 6 months prior to that 41. 41 and the other 42, but like a 6 months or there a gap.
So they're still wandering around?
They are, absolutely. And people, honestly, people would see, they would see, because they haven't gone over properly, they would see unusual, maybe shapes, shadowy figures, sometimes at speed and sometimes very slowly, and would probably fade away from them, you know, in different directions. So I would guarantee there is phenomena taking place in this area.
Well, that's what happened last night. Let's see if the historians can throw any light on that. He mentioned Canadian two men, this name Mac. What do you make of that, Richard Felix?
Well, we do know the names of the two people that died at that site. They were both English. There's no doubt about that. And neither of them that I know of would have had the nickname of Mac, I'm sure of it, because one's name was Jones and one was Humpage, and you know, it was common in the Air Force to give people a nickname. Somebody McCubbin would be known as Mac McCubbin, and so on and so on. But the thing that I do find quite interesting is that he mentioned the fact that they don't know that they're dead, that they don't know they've left their earthly body.
Right.
And one of the things I was going to say, with so many young lives, people dying between the age of 18, 20, 25, terrible shock of death. And it's something that I genuinely believe, that these poor chaps don't even know they're dead. Hence the fact that they're still haunting the site.
I was about to say, is that the reason that they may still be?
I think so. And then the only other thing he mentioned was that they seemed to be separate. One of them was killed at the time, but the other chap, who strangely enough was a leading aircraftsman, who was only a mechanic, who had only gone up, he was from here, from this base. He only went up to test out the plane and was killed, but he died later.
Right. Okay, very good. Thank you. Very good work indeed. I have got some very interesting news about our chamber, okay, which I'm going to tell you now, because over here is a member of our audience who has just let me know something about the chamber. Hi there.
Hi.
Tell me your name.
Gavin.
And you live nearby?
I do, yes.
And you know something about this chamber?
Yeah, my dad used to work here in the 60s, and the chamber was used predominantly during the war and the Cold War as a observation point for planes flying over. And other planes coming in as well.
So you know this chamber exists?
Yes.
Do you know where it is?
Yes, my dad told me.
So well, that's very good, isn't it? Yeah. Don't tell us now, okay. Though, will you? But that's great news, so that we know this chamber does now exist. Let's go over to Julian and find out what people at home have been saying. Julian.
Okay, well, I tell you, it's been an extraordinary response to this chamber experiment we've been running. Over 30,000 people have gone to the website to predict where they think the chamber is, and that's what we asked you to do, to click on the map and predict where you thought the chamber was. And there we have, we've done the statistics on this. 78% of you who went online chose that spot, which is quite amazing. But what about Derek and David? Let's find out. Derek, first of all, where do you think it is, Derek?
Derek, where do you think the chamber is?
Well, we're actually standing here. I get the tip of the chamber. And what is very unusual to me, visualising the shape of this chamber, it seems to me to be going in a more oblong size and then going off. So I feel like we've got like three, an entrance, going to another area, and then going off like a semi-T. Okay. So it's like three.
Is this the main area then? Is that
why
we're
centered
here?
Here, yes.
Okay.
And going this way, and also in that direction, oblong. This way, that way.
Okay. All right. So that's where you think the chamber is.
Yes.
And funnily enough, David Wells, you're just over here.
I am. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So David Wells is already positioned where he thinks Julian.
Let's put Derek in the map first of all. Derek is basically there. And then David, David Wells, where are you and where do you think it is? Let's see if we can catch up with David to find out where he thinks it is. But if you look at the Derek amazingly very near to that spot where 78% of you have predicted the chamber is. And David, I think not too far away from there. But we think David, in fact, I've just been told that David is just by the tank. So there's the tank. And David Wells thinks the chamber is there. And Derek is there. So, David, just tell us where you are to clarify that for us. David Wells, are you there? So I think David.
Yeah, I definitely feel it's here, just on this slight rise here, definitely.
Okay,
yeah,
and you're near the tank.
Yeah, I'm just right in front of the tank. Yeah.
About 10 feet away from it. Okay. Kieran, what do you think to the fact that our two mediums are very close to each other and they've both wandered around the whole area?
Well, if they're...
So there we are. David there in front of the tank, Derek there, and that's where you, the majority, 78% of you said the chamber is. So we really have everything tying together there. A consensus of opinion, David.
I have to say that is absolutely extraordinary. I didn't expect that at all, that you at home and then, of course, David Wells and also Derek also saying that the chamber is there. Well, I can tell you now that I'm joined now by Dr. Jamie Pringle. He's from the University of Kiel. Now, we have asked him to conduct a radar survey of the site chosen by you, Derek, and David Wells. So he's here to do that. Now, tell me about this radar investigation. How does this work?
Sure. It's a transmitter and a receiver, and it transmits pulses of electromagnetic energy into the subsurface, and then it reflects. When it hits an object, it will reflect back to a receiver again, and you move along a profile line, so you acquire a series of 2D profile lines along the ground.
So using this technique, you would hope that if there was a chamber there, that you would visualise it?
Hopefully.
We shall see, though. So the question is, are they right? Have they chosen the right location for this chamber? Well, Dr. Pringle will start his investigation right now. We will bring you the results of that. We'll also visit one of the most haunted buildings on this site. All of that in just a few minutes' time. Welcome back. So much has happened already tonight, and I have to tell you that Yvette and Derek are on their way right now to the shower block. It's the scene of one of the most regular paranormal occurrences on this site, because two men are often seen here, one of whom is said to have a distinguishing mark upon his body. Now, earlier we asked Brian Shepherd here, who's our psychic artist, to spend some time in that room and to see what images came to him. Our resident skeptic, Louis Saver, then sealed those drawings in the envelope, which he's holding right now. And we will open that a little later on. But we do need you to get involved as well with this this experiment. And Julian has more.
Yeah, well, as ever, we want you to send us your psychic drawings. Every time we do Most Haunted Live, we get a big response on this, and very important tonight to see your pictures to compare with the experiment. So fax your drawings right away, please, to this number, 01341 241 771. So fax your psychic drawings now to 01341 241 771, and then we will compare and contrast, David, in a wee while.
Very good. I love the sound of that experiment. Thank you very much indeed. Tonight has been fantastic so far. So why the shower block? What's been seen there? And what is the strange connection between the shower block and another site, the officer's mess?
During the war, the officer's mess was the busy social centre of the camp. For scores of servicemen and women based here, the mess was their only sanctuary, a place to escape the rigours of training and the enormous, often unbearable stress of violent combat. The well-trodden route from the mess to the abandoned shower block was once a busy thoroughfare. At around 6 a.m. each morning, the deserted shower block seems to come alive with the eerie sound of running water, echoey footsteps, and men chatting. At other times, residents have been awoken by the presence of a number of men at the foot of their bed. Also, two ghostly and distinguished airmen frequently startle staff and visitors to both the sergeant's mess and the shower block. Is it possible they could be the same men in two different locations? Rumours are rife of men suffering immense personal torment through battle stress and grief at the loss of close friends and comrades. But why are these two airmen so determined to make their presence felt? And is there more to the connection between the two rooms?
Well, I'm joined now by Carwin Roberts. He works on the site here, don't you? You work in the kitchen.
That's right.
Now, you've experienced a lot of paranormal activity on this site. Tell us a bit about what's happened to you in that particular... It's the officer's mess that you've seen a lot of things. What have you seen?
Now and again, when you're working in the kitchen, a lot of times you'll hear doors bang. Mostly the doors between the officer's mess and the restaurant will open on themselves. And then the back door of the kitchen will open and then shut, like someone's walked through but there's no one there.
And there is no one there?
There's no one there.
Have you ever seen a figure?
Yeah, usually when you're cleaning in the restaurant and you know there's not a lot of people on site, they're usually looking around the museum or something, you often see someone walk past inside the function room very quickly, just a quick shadow or something. You go in to see there's no one there.
Can you just, when you see that shadow, can you make anything out of the shadow or just the shadow?
You can see sort of a shape, I would say like a man's shape at all, but nothing else. It's very quick.
And before this happened to you, were you a skeptic? Are you a skeptic now, or you now believe?
I was quite open-minded before. Never actually experienced anything before. When I came to work in, things started happening, things started kicking off, now I'm a bit more towards the believing side.
Louis, what do you make of Carwin and what he's telling you?
I mean, it's very interesting. You have to remember there's a mythology about this place. You know, it is touted as this most haunted place in Britain. So it's not unsurprising that people are witnessing, you know, doors banging as being paranormal events. Well, it's very windy here tonight. I'm sure doors are banging all over the place. So,
and what would persuade you, though? You know, Carwin is a rational young man. Sure. He's not making this up, are you?
No.
What would persuade you?
Externally corroborated evidence, maybe videotape might be very interesting to have a look at.
I can't tell you, isn't it?
It is very difficult.
When you're cleaning the kitchen to have a video camera with you.
It certainly is, isn't it? Even when we're out, we're not finding that evidence. So, I don't know, we'll have to see.
So, let me get this right, Louis. You're not impressed at all by what you've seen tonight?
Unfortunately not, no, not so far.
I'm just looking around at the audience's faces at that point. Yeah, well, I didn't think they would like that. David Wells, what would you say to Carwin? You know, Carwin has seen these things, he's experienced these phenomena. What would your take be on this?
Well, I think it's very interesting that Carwin's not looking for this. And very often, when you have a sighting or a sensation or a feeling, you're going about your daily business. You're not consciously thinking, oh, where are they? You know, you're washing the dishes or whatever. Like, exactly, Carwin was in the kitchen working away. And it's just skim, so you're not looking for it. And that's archetypally when you're going to see it.
What would you say to Louis?
It's probably a bit early in the day, actually, to say it. I would say, you know, I know Louis gets out there and he goes out there and he sees these places. So he does visit haunted places and he sees it from a different perspective. But again, he's there and he's going, where are you? You know, and it's very difficult. Whereas if you just go about your daily, sometimes, you know, and the crew, when we're just doing our ordinary stuff, in it comes.
Okay. I have to tell you, Lou, we've had a lot of responses from people watching at home. Thank you very much for those. And in particular, a lot of them are saying you should lighten up.
Okay.
What would you say to that?
Well, maybe it's the brown that I'm wearing. Maybe I should have worn a different colour.
Is the answer not to look for it? Is it to be more open-minded, like Carwin?
Yeah, I agree. It's definitely been open-minded. And not to constantly go, where are you, because it's when you're not looking, like everything else in life, you find it.
Perfect. Great answer. Thank you very much indeed. Let's go over to Julian for an update. Julian.
Thanks, David. Well, as ever, we like to hear the stories about what's happening to you at home whilst the programme's on. And whilst watching Derek in a trance, many people got in touch by text and on the website, and strange things happened. Tina Crossley in Goulbourne says that their video switched itself off and no one was near the remote control, no one was near the machine either. Harry Stephen in Weston-super-Mare says it felt like I was being watched during that trance and my cupboards flew open during that, something had happened at home. Kenji Kirk and Emily in Nottingham were all watching at that point, and two of them suddenly had nosebleeds during the seance. Now, other things you need to know, the EVP experiment, which we were asking you to do, which was the sounds that you can download on the website. Almost every viewer tonight has reported hearing a man's voice saying no, clearly on track one. And some said he seemed quite annoyed, like he was being asked a question, and then he went, no, that's on the EVP, which we were mentioning earlier, these recordings. Many others, such as Claire Greener in Warrington, Justin from Poole, and Ray from Harrogate, saying the same thing. Also, track two sounds like someone is playing pool or snooker. It definitely sounds like balls clacking. Is what people say. Now, the webcams, now, just to update what people are saying on that, webcam one, the shower block, Michelle from Barking in Essex saw flashing lights in the shower block. Carl and Sharon from Bolton have also seen a line of light flickering on the right-hand wall. That's webcam one in the shower block. And Tracy from Torquay has also seen unusual light activity. Anna and Kelly, or now we move to webcam four, if we may, which is the 1940s room there. Activity round the bed. Anna and Kelly from Widnes report the quilt moving, and Sue Warren from Swindon has seen the bed's valance moving on its own. That's on webcam four. So that's another trend that's coming through. And then just the other two webcams quickly. Webcam two here, the young girl. They can see a young girl on webcam two. And then webcam three, flickering lights is the trend there. So that's the latest on the webcams. And David, back to you.
Lovely, thank you very much indeed, Julian. Okay, it's time to find out exactly where Yvette has got to. Let's go over to meet her now. Yvette, are you there?
Yeah, David, we are. We're here
now. Yvette, are you there?
Yeah, David, we are here in the shower block. And what there's been so many people have witnessed feelings in here, sounds in here, particularly sounds. So we're coming right through. It starts off with a big wide room. We're walking down this corridor here towards where the webcam is. I was listening through my earpiece, and a lot of people at home have actually seen flashing lights on the webcam. So it'll be interesting to see if we pick anything up here on our night vision cameras. So, Derek, what do you actually pick up as soon as we come into the shower block?
Well, I've become very aware. Now, I feel this is residual energy, mm-hmm. meaning it's not a spirit person at this moment in time here. But what I heard, and it was very, very clear, was a conversation that was going on. It was between two males. And I just asked Sam, because it wasn't in English, and I said to Sam, what is that, you know, that I'm listening to? And he said, this individual that I'd heard talking to another was talking in Polish.
Right.
It was a Polish man here, strutting up and down, and quite angry indeed, because he was speaking, the voice link I was getting from the residual energy was, you know, throwing out this, like, anger. And I can't make out what the anger was.
How do you know it's Polish, though? Do you know the language? Can you pick up on certain words?
No, I heard. I thought, in actual fact, I thought I was hearing Russian. And I had to confirm with Sam. And he said to me, no, this is a Polish man talking to another Polish man.
Right.
And I could hear the one talking, and now and again, the other one replying. But he seemed to be angry with the other Polish man.
Can you find out why he's angry?
Come on, Sam, help me. I feel what actually happened was, from what I'm receiving here, is that these two Polish, the only way I can put it, they were most certainly military, maybe airmen, was that the Polish man with the angered voice was very upset, talking about, thank you, Sam, thank you for helping me with this. The conversation, according to Sam, was about another airman that lost his life. And the person who was strutting up and down was saying it didn't have to happen. It shouldn't have happened. He did not need to lose his life the way he did. It wasn't even in combat.
How did he lose his life?
How did he lose his life, son? He was out in a training exercise with others, and they were...
What was that?
Did you hear that? That sounded like a footstep.
Yeah. Did you hear that? Did anybody else hear it?
Very strong, wasn't it? Like as if the heel went down.
Like that? Like my heel?
Just like that. Yeah.
Yeah.
That's probably him.
Nobody moving. There's nobody moving down here.
That's probably him.
Yeah.
That could be his anger, you see, because it's thick and fast. His residual energy is here. Now, maybe he has come in now. But I feel he was angered because a fellow comrade lost his life in a training accident. That's the only way I can put it. It wasn't even in, like, war-torn conditions.
He was just training?
Yes.
Right.
And he doesn't even belong here. Go on, Sam, say it. He comes from another part. I mean, if he's a Polish, naturally he comes from Poland. But no, Sam's trying to say he doesn't come from this area. He's been sent here to do training to fire. Fire, that's what went wrong. He was firing at targets. Thank you, Sam. And apparently, whatever happened came back and exploded the plane. And it's been a big cover-up. And this Polish airman is saying it's been covered up. It's wrong. What he was saying in Polish was it's wrong. Whoever the
you're getting angry. You're
yeah,
getting angry
I get
as you're
these
talking.
Feelings. It's like he said, I just want to go to my commandant or whatever, a man in super, and stamp down on the desk and say, you know, that should have been. The shells or whatever it is shouldn't have been packed that way. And that's why he lost his life. It's, you know, and a good pilot and a good friend. And angered, but he couldn't do it because his other friend was saying, you can't do that. You can't not do that.
Derek, do you feel that there's a presence actually here in this room?
Yes,
now?
I do.
You do?
I feel that he's been listening to us now.
Do you have a name? Can Sam give you a name for this person?
Can you give me a name, Sam? Ask him, Sam. Approach him and ask him. What? Okay, thank you. It's weird. Sam says he's asked him and he won't. He won't give him his name. He won't speak to him.
Is he not very nice?
He's angered.
He's angry.
He's very, very hot-tempered, soulless.
Can you give us a date then?
When was this? When was that, please? Come on. Yes? What? When it happened? Please, Sam, ask him. Ask him. He's willing to give him that.
We're okay. Going to find out after the break, okay. Derek. Please join us after the break when we're going to leave one of our investigators here totally on their own. Who will that be? They don't even know that yet. Join us after the break.
Well, welcome back to Most Haunted Live. This is the first of three nights here in North West Wales in Llanbedrog. Just before the break, we were talking about what was happening in the shower block. We heard footsteps, a plane exploded, a cover-up. But I just want to go back to something else about this cover-up. Now, I was just talking to Carwin in the break. You said to me you'd heard this before. Tell me about that.
Yeah, we had a medium. She was down about a few months back. And we went into the RAF Museum and did a seance up in what's now the crew room, which was the old projector room. And while we were there, she picked up very strongly on a cover-up. She said she couldn't pinpoint...
Did she say the words cover-up?
She did, yeah. She said there was something that had been covered up because something had happened, and she couldn't exactly pinpoint what it was, but something bad had happened and had been covered up.
Brilliant. So that's the second time you've heard those words cover up. Were you surprised when Derek...
I was quite shocked, actually, yeah.
All right. Well, let's go and find out from the historians what they make of that. Let me just go back before we go to the cover up. I want to go back to the Wellington crash site. Derek came up with this name, Mac. We weren't sure about that. But, Richard Jones, you've got some light on that.
We do have a squadron leader, James, and his nickname was Mac. In 1943, he went on a rhubarb op. And that was flying beneath low clouds, and it was a nuisance raid to sort of damage German aircraft deep in France,
right.
Wipe out radar targets. And he was an incredible character because he lost an arm fighting in Malta. He'd been shot off by cannon fire. And he had a steel contraption with fingers and came quickly back into service. And then he went on several rhubarb ops, but for the second one he failed to come back from his op. He was shot down over France, and he died 3 weeks after being shot down in a French hospital. And his nickname was Mac, and he was resting at Llanbedrog. He was resting at the Air Force Base.
Really?
A lot of pilots came from the
heading field to Derek got a name right?
He got the name Mac. He wasn't associated with that particular crash or that crash site.
All right.
But Mac, he was a very strong character.
All right. Richard, the other Richard.
Showers.
Let's talk about the showers.
Yeah, a lot of people know this already. I'm often talking about toilet ghosts. People laugh, but the number of haunted toilets, washrooms, shower rooms there are, it's all down to water, it's earth energy and recordings. And the amazing thing is that Derek's come up with a Polish pilot, and there was a Polish pilot that actually made a mistake on the Rangers and actually shot someone else, killed them. Now, whether it was covered up, whether he kept quiet about it and the emotion, the thoughts of it stayed with him, and they're actually, for some reason, recorded in the fabric of that building where the water was, I'm not sure, but I find that amazing. That's very good.
And the fact that Carwin was saying about this other medium saying cover up. Derek saying cover up.
Yeah, cover up of this Polish man shooting another Polish man on the Rangers.
You like it?
I like it.
Thank you very much indeed. Okay, well, I hope you're keeping up with what's going on, because there is so much happening tonight. Let me just recap as to where we are. Now, Yvette and Derek have had some amazing experiences in the shower block already. We already heard about the footsteps and so on, and this idea of a cover-up. But what they've now decided to do is to split the vigil. They are moving on to the officers' mess, but they've left someone at the shower block to monitor the situation. Let's find out from the woman herself what she's up to. Yvette, why have you decided to split this vigil?
Well, David, the reason why we've done a split vigil is much of the paranormal activity has actually happened in two of the rooms. One in the shower block and the other one here in the officer's mess, which we're about to go into. And at the same time, similar noises are heard, cold spots will be felt, lights are often seen in both of these rooms at simultaneous times. So we thought it'd be a really good idea to leave one person behind in the shower block while the rest of us moved on to the next location.
Well, that begs the question, who was the lucky stroke unlucky person to be left on their own?
It was Kath.
Yvette Fielding, you are... There she is! Oh, Kath! You don't look very happy. How is it going down there?
It's horrible. I feel that there's somebody in here with me. It's horrible. I'm so scared to move.
And we know from the series and from the investigations that you've done that you are known to get frightened. How much do you think it is your imagination running wild, and how much is it do you think there is really a presence there with you?
Oh, I don't know. It's just so scary. Every place we go to is just so scary. It's horrible. I'm sure somebody's in here with me.
Okay.
I don't think I can stay here any longer.
Okay, tell me what you're actually feeling now.
It's weird. I can hear noises behind me, even like footsteps. It's like I don't know, a whole kind of atmosphere in here. I've gone really cold. I'm shivering. Even the camera, I can't hold it properly because I'm so cold. And I'll stay here a little bit longer, but if I can't do it anymore, I'm going to have to leave. I'm so sorry.
All right. Well, look, the best of luck to you. We'll keep a camera on you, keep you monitored whilst you stay there. What I'm going to do now is cross back over to Yvette. Now, Yvette, what are you going to do from here?
Right, from here, we're actually going to go into the officers' mess, which an awful lot of paranormal activity has occurred in this particular room. And in fact, many people have seen spirits in here. So that's where we're heading off to now.
Okay, and how do you feel about the fact that you've been really, really unpleasant and left Kath on her own?
Well, you know, I mean, somebody's got to stay behind, haven't they, really?
And why did you choose Kath particularly?
Because Kath, when we've done the series, Kath is often quite sensitive. And I know mediums that have worked with Kath, she often picks things up. When she asks during seance, things will often happen to her. As you saw in the seance at the beginning of the programme, she was often being touched on the top of her head. So we actually feel that Kath is quite sensitive. She picks up on these things. And, you know, she's a logical person. So that's why we've chosen Kath to stay there for us.
All right. Thank you very much. Yvette, why don't you go and get in position where you need to be? I can see you've got some of the audience with you at the moment. You need to go and get into position. Why don't you go and do that right now?
Yeah, we're going to do that. Just before I do that, I just want to explain that there is a small audience slot here with us. Give us a round of applause. Yay! There they all are. And the reason being is they have travelled, all of our audience members have travelled for miles upon miles, and some of them, literally, we didn't have enough room for them, so we've squeezed them in here into the haunted tea room, may I add. It is actually haunted in here, and they're going to sit here and be... Could I ask you to be incredibly quiet while we go and do our investigation in the next room, the officer's mess? If any of you feel anything, experience anything, please let one of the members of staff know, and then we'll come and talk to you afterwards. Okay, so please keep very, very quiet. And as we move into the officer's mess, I just want to ask Kath if she can hear me. Kath, yes, can you hear me?
I can hear you.
Are you all right?
Yeah, it's, do you know, it's weird. There's like a smell of burning, not like there's a fire, but I don't know if that means anything.
Okay. Are you really that scared now?
No, I've sort of calmed down now, but just the initial start of being here, it's a strange feeling.
Would you like David Wells or Brian Shepherd to come in there with you? Would you, or are you all right for the time being? If you do want somebody to come in with you, they will go in there with you, Kath.
I feel okay at the moment, but if anybody wishes to join me, that's fine.
Okay, well, just let us know if your experience... What Kathy's actually experiencing is the smell of burning. She's heard footsteps. Am I right, Kath?
Yes.
Okay, just I can hear you in my ear, so if you actually pick up on anything there...
Okay.
It'll be interesting to see if we pick up on anything similar in this particular room. Okay, so here we are in... God, it's dark.
Yeah,
and it's a big, big room, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
It is massive.
Can't tell how big it is.
No, you can't. It's absolutely huge.
Mm-hmm.
Okay,
you know, this is going to sound absolutely silly to you, Evie, even strange, but what is actually...
Did you hear that?
Yeah, I did.
Hear what?
At the back of us.
Yeah, like a...
Shh. Yeah.
Is there anybody there? What is that?
Over there.
Look at the room.
Yeah, over here now.
Let's walk over.
It's coming around.
I can't hear anything now. I heard
stopped.
A shh sound. It was like a like some movement at the back of the room.
Yeah.
Can we see anything on the night vision cameras, John? Is there anything there?
You can see something. It's very faint.
Do you want to move forward? Should we go towards that area?
Yeah, let's move forward.
Sorry, Derek.
It's all right.
Who heard that?
I heard it.
Did you hear it, Kieran?
Yeah.
I didn't hear it.
Did anybody else hear it?
Yes.
You did.
You know
Carl?
What it was like? It was. It was the chair being just moved. And the energy here. There's a spirit man here. Okay? Who? Go on, Sam. Ask him. Ask him. He won't give it to me. Okay. Mac. There's a Mac again. Mac, is that same Mac? Is it the same Mac that was outside? It's not? Okay.
It's a different one.
It's an officer. McLachlan. Is that the same name? He's an officer.
Can you see him?
I can't see him, but I know
there.
His energy's there.
Let's go
and it's McLachlan.
McLachlan? Is there anybody here?
God. It's okay, it's all right.
Please join us after the break when we try and find
McLachlan.
Out and make more contact with this energy here. Please join us after the break. God. Can you feel it?
Well, welcome back to Most Haunted Live, an incredible night so far. Without further ado, let's go and join Yvette, Derek and the rest of the team.
Okay, so you're picking something up that's
yes.
different?
Yes.
What do you mean?
Well, all of a sudden, just a moment, a couple of seconds ago, I just happened to look at the back of me and then look down that way, and all I saw was, what they were. They were airmen, and there was a lot of women, and they were dancing, and there was music. And it was like, a lot of them were shouting, and it was like, the whole atmosphere was like as if I'm, you know, it's like, they're just enjoying themselves, a large group of people, men and women, dancing, and then some of them singing, and this whole atmosphere was so, so joyful. And the sounds, for that short space of time, was such a happy... A happy atmosphere here. It's a good atmosphere here in this place, and I feel a lot of memories. Maybe this is why a lot of these spirit souls are coming back through the memory, the happiness that they actually had when they were here, taking away all the tensions and what have you. This particular place here, this you know large room, is where they could relax and just wind down and forget, you know, worries. To do with war time and things like this, but I feel there was a lot of plans that were talked about even after times of this enjoyment. I'm also getting, and I suppose it's allowed, I'm getting in the residual energy here, a lot of males who are rather worse for the drink, and I get a group of the men now all with their arms around each other's shoulders and singing a particular song, and it's just like There's nothing negative about this atmosphere, this ether.
Nothing at all.
Nothing at all.
When we all heard the sound behind us, which was a shh noise, I definitely heard it, you heard it, Carl heard it. And you then came up with the name of Mac, but you say it's a separate name to the one that you talked about outside.
Yes, it's a separate one, yes.
Okay, is he, because you were saying he's over in that corner there,
yes.
Is he still there now?
Well, I'm not picking up his energy there at this moment.
So has he moved?
He's moved.
So is he in this atmosphere here?
I can't tell, he may have stepped out of it. But you know what Sam said, Sam questioned him, and this is why I almost immediately said, McLachlan, and
okay.
I feel officer, you know, maybe a top man, a position, high position, a man with authority, a man that's made decisions, and I feel at times McLachlan, Mac, made plans in here.
And is he active here?
I feel he comes in, yes.
Okay, well hopefully we'll be able to sort of pick up on some of the activity over the next few nights.
Mm-hmm.
David, whether that name makes any sense to our historians?
Yes, well, I'll find out right now, because we've heard that name McLachlan twice now. I need to go and ask you, Richard Jones, tell me about McLachlan. Mac.
Well, it does seem to be, again, this James that we came up with.
Right.
Maybe the outside one was a different one altogether, but certainly he was resting here. He was a squadron leader, and Derek then did say that he was a person of some authority and high command. The thing about the base, of course, was that a lot of crews from the southern counties of England actually came resting here, and also to retrain pilots, because one thing to remember is that the losses were phenomenal during the war, and this was they were brought here to be retrained and also to rest as well. But of course, as we're with Mac, he couldn't resist going on a few over-channel raids.
But it was interesting, wasn't it, that we heard Mac, and then we heard Mac again, and then it became McLachlan.
Yeah. Well, he said McLachlan.
McLachlan, sorry,
yes,
we've paraphrased it.
Yeah. Which would be correct.
So you're quite impressed by that, though?
It's reasonably impressed. I mean, it's public domain still. But
all right. Okay, thank you for the moment. Well, we're always very, very intrigued to know what stories you have at home and also people here. Now, I'm just coming over here because where's Sean gone? Here you are. Now, Sean, you work here as well.
Yes.
Now, Carwin told us some stories. He's sitting next to you now, earlier, about what sort of phenomenon he's witnessed here.
Yes, yeah.
Tell us about the shower block and your experience there.
Right, well, it's very strange. I was staying as a guest, actually, and I was staying in a room adjacent to where Kath is at the moment. And I was woken up about 6:10 hearing the shuffling of feet and muffled voices. And I sat up in bed because I thought, am I asleep or, you know, am I dreaming sort of thing? And I was wide awake anyway. I could hear sort of conversation, people coming in, going out, and the strange thing was it was almost like in stereo, it was coming from all around me, but behind me, if you know what I mean. And all of a sudden there was a sound of running water, and it lasted for about probably 15 minutes, and it was absolutely incredible, and then just stopped almost as suddenly, if you know what I mean. But I was sort of sat up thinking, what the heck is this? Then got up about 8:30, went next door, and I said to Shirley, what time did you get up? And she said, we've been up about 5 minutes. I said, you've not been in the room behind at all this morning? And she said, no, not at all. Explained what I'd heard, and she went, oh, right, that's quite incredible sort of thing. But it sounded like probably 11 or 12 people basically showering.
Right, and you think this was paranormal?
Oh, definitely, definitely, yeah.
Very good. Thank you, Sean. Thank you very much indeed. Okay, now earlier on, if you remember, we asked our psychic artist here to go into the shower block and to draw a picture, which is in the envelope. May I have that? Okay. Now, I think it's time to reveal what you drew. Now, just tell us a bit about the psychic art. You feel a presence there, do you, whilst you draw this?
Yes, indeed. I walked into the shower block and took a walk around and didn't feel... I felt nothing, to be honest. But after a while, there was evidence of noise, of people moving around, and there was evidence of a few figures just walking around.
Okay.
And then a calm, and then a presence of one figure.
And this is the
figure that I've drawn.
And you felt this drawing. There it is. This is what Brian has drawn. There we are. There is the figure in the shower room, according to Brian. Okay. Julian, I know we've been asking members of the audience to fax in their psychic art. Do we have anything that matches this?
Well, yeah, obviously we're doing this literally as live as they come in on the facts here, but let's have a look there. That's from Marion there. That's from Chris in Edgbaston. That one's come through. There's another one from Mark that's come through there. There's another one, Squadron Leader Jack Travis, says Bruce, who said send that one there in the facts. Thank you, Bruce, for that. So that's come through. It's got a hat on. There we are. And interestingly, a scar there. And actually, I think
it's a scar on the face there, yeah?
Yeah, and I've got there's another one there with a scar on the face, which has come through on the facts as well. So those are the ones we've had so far. Can I just say, David,
yes.
The competition. I just want to tell you about the competition that we ran earlier. Who's going to go and come and join us on Monday night? I just want to say hello to Shelley from Birmingham, Sue from Warwickshire, Beverly from Shrewsbury, Wendy from Basingstoke, and Graham from Weston-super-Mare. The answer was Bewley, the home of the National Motor Museum, where Most Haunted Life came from. So well done to all of them, and back to you.
Lovely. Thank you very much indeed. Well, tonight has been full of surprises, but it is now time for our tonight's major experiment. We're going to conduct a sealed room experiment. Now, we've chosen a location for this which has frequent poltergeist activity. I'm delighted to say that Shirley Green is here with me now. Now, you actually run this as the heritage site, don't
yes,
you?
Yes, we do.
You've witnessed a lot of phenomenon here.
Yes, quite a lot. Yes, we have.
Which room particularly?
Well, we have experienced it all over the site. Every single room.
But there is one room, this 1940s room.
1940s room, yes, we have.
What is this 1940s room?
1940s room, it was just an empty building basically. And it was actually transformed into an exhibit of a 1940s house.
Okay.
Basically, the scenario is a 1940s living room and a 1940s bedroom. And we did actually experience something in the bedroom.
What did you see in the 1940s room, though?
Right, well, basically, it was the end of the season, and usually we strip all the bed linen off, that sort of thing. At the beginning of the season, I'd refreshed all the bed linen, made all the bed up, and smoothed it all out. It was perfectly smooth,
right.
Starched. One particular day after we'd done this, I was showing a friend around the museum, and we happened to be looking in the bedroom, just leaning over the bar, looking at the bedroom of the 1940s house, and we noticed an indent in the pillow. Quite a severe indent,
right.
As if someone had been lying there.
Had someone been lying there?
No, nobody had been in the room at all since I'd done it. The rest of the bed wasn't ruffled up at all, it was just the pillow. And it has happened on a second time as well.
And you're convinced that's paranormal?
Yes.
Lovely.
We did think at first that someone may have been in there, but afterwards, I mean, you know, the room was locked.
And also with all the stories from your staff as well, so lots of people are witnessing strange things.
Yes.
Okay, let's move now to Yvette. She is in the 1940s room. She's got Louis Sava, also Kieran O'Keefe, with her now. Yvette, tell us about this sealed room experiment.
Okay, well, here we are in the 1940s room, and as you can see, it has sort of things that, you know, are from that era. The furniture, the clothing, everything. And as Shirley said, one of the things that has been caught here is the indentation on the pillow here that you can see. As you can see, we've plumped up the pillows, we've not touched them at all. In fact, no one's touched this bed at all while any of the web cameras have been going. Now, I've got Louis here and Kieran. What sort of things are we going to be doing in this particular room?
Well, specifically, we've got a torch shining a beam of light across the bed. A lot of eyewitnesses have said when they've come in with torches, the beam has been refracted, it's actually been bent. So
okay.
We've got that going across the bed. We've got trigger objects,
yeah.
Antique coins on graph paper. There's circles drawn around them. We've also got a camcorder here that's going to film across the bed. We've got talcum powder around.
On the floor.
And on the floor, which is a protection against fraud. We're going to see if there's any footsteps in there. And also, we're going to record on VHS for about 8 hours.
Okay.
Got an MP3 recorder set up there, which is going to go for 24 hours. And we've also got a Polaroid, which is going to take Polaroid photos on a timer about every hour.
Okay. And are you happy with the experiment?
Yes,
really?
Certainly.
Okay.
It looks very interesting. I'd like to see it.
Okay. Well, what we're going to do is we're going to seal off this room. Please join us after the break. We're going to seal off the room. Join us after the break and find out where we're going to next.
Welcome back to Most Haunted, live from North Wales. An incredible night so far. So much has happened. And so much has happened to our audience over here, because on this show, it's a totally, totally live show. We never know what's going to happen. I just want to introduce you to two of our audience members. What's your name?
Stephanie.
Stephanie and?
Tess.
Tess. Okay. You two have seen the same thing tonight.
Yeah.
What did you see?
I saw a man playing peekaboo behind a tree, dressed in a green uniform. And he got like a cloth cap on with a red stripe round it, and his trousers were in his boots.
And what did you think was odd about a man in a green uniform?
Because this is an RAF site, not an army site.
Right, so you were expecting a blue uniform?
Blue uniform, not green.
And what did this man do?
Smile and laugh and beckon us over as if to say, I know what you're doing in there, come and find out, come and play outside. And he just keeps staring at me.
Did you see exactly the same thing?
Yeah, and he knows exactly what's going off in here, and he wants somebody to go and see him.
Okay, and you are convinced that this was not someone who's living today?
No.
Why?
Because of the way he was dressed. The fact that the weather, and he's just standing out there, and, you know.
So you think you saw a ghost tonight outside here?
Yep.
There you are. Thank you very much indeed. Okay, well, I told you it's extraordinary what happens here on Most Haunted Live. It is the world's biggest live ghost hunt. What we need to do now is to ask a member of our audience to join the investigation team for our next vigil. Now, as you can see, the searchlights are moving amongst our audience now. We have actually taken the names of all of our studio audience. We've picked out one at random. And that name is? It's Nicole Price. Where are you, Nicole? There you are. Stand up, Nicole. Okay, give her a round of applause. Right, Nicole, I want you to go and join Neil there. He'll take you out to join the rest of the team. Would you like to go and do that now? Okay. David Wells, would you like to go and join them as well?
What?
There you go, David Wells. Give him a round of applause as he heads out as well. Thank you very much indeed. So there you go. Nicole minding her own business there in the audience, and she's been sent out to join the investigative team. Meanwhile, Julian has some more information for us.
Well, very busy at the moment, and trends during the evening, David, just to tell you that many viewers have experienced much strange things happening whilst we've been on air. Video recorders, TVs, microwaves, washing machines, switching themselves on and off as the programme goes on. And just a thought on the 1940s, and lots of you seeing the mannequin at the back of the room moving on that webcam. Carolyn Clydebank, Sharon in Southport, Sarah in Ipswich both saw her moving. So there you are. David, back to you.
Lovely. Thank you very much indeed, Julian. Okay, we're going to move now to our investigative team that now Nicole is joining. So let's go and join them right now, live.
Well, we're here in the sergeant's quarters. This is where we did the seance at the beginning of the programme. And what we've decided to do is actually come back to this place, because we all felt, didn't we, that it was actually, things were happening here.
Yeah.
And we thought, before we close tonight, it would be good to actually come back and see if there's anything else that we can pick up, and maybe try and encourage more paranormal activity, because we all heard the bang on the roof, we heard noises, and definite cold spots. So if anybody here, you know, the team experience anything, then, you know, just shout out, for goodness sake, we must do. So what do you want to? What do you think would be the right thing to do, just to start off, Derek? Should we just sort of be quiet? Maybe I ask out, or
I think we will get some results from Elliot if we kindly speak out to them.
Okay. All right.
Okay. I think they'll respond to you, being the lady. Okay.
Okay. Is there anybody here? Jeffrey, Ian, if you can hear my voice. I know you can't probably see us, but if you can hear my voice, please could you try and communicate with us? I said we would come back here, and we have done. Please could you come forward? Please give us a sign to let us know that you're here. Please talk to us. Please do something. Are you here in this room with us now? If you are, please could you touch one of us? Could you try and talk to us? Could you try and move something? If you can, please come forward. Please try and move something. Try and talk to us in any way you can. Make the temperature drop. Show yourself in spirit lights. Anything at all.
Is there anybody here? Are there any spirit people here in this room with us now? If you are, please can you come forward? Please try and talk to one of us. Please come through. Come forward. Is there anybody here? Is there anybody here at all in this room now? Are you picking anything up, Derek?
Oh, it seems as if, you know, I'm not even picking up listening ears yet.
Nothing.
It seems so.
Is somebody shouting then? Is anybody else here shouting? It was a man's voice shouting. Is it somebody outside?
Should I go and check?
Yeah, do. I heard a man shouting.
We'll go out as well. Come back.
Okay.
Second.
Okay.
But I don't think anybody would shout.
No.
Not
no.
Not. Is there anybody here? Please try and talk to us. Please try and. I can swear I could hear shouting again.
Yeah.
Is there anybody here in this room with us now? Please come forward. Anything? What was
it's
that?
Kieran. It's Kieran. It's okay, Yvette. Kieran.
Yeah, unfortunately there's somebody who walked about 10 feet away
right.
On that side of the building with
okay.
The radio too loud.
Do you want to try Shall we try a little bit of table tipping?
We can do
yeah.
Do you want to try that?
Then maybe that would, you know,
help?
Encourage activity.
Okay.
Yeah.
Kath, Stuart, do you want to come?
Certainly.
Yeah, let's go. Okay, Kieran, do you want to explain what table tipping is and why we're using... Do we do it without chairs, Stuart? And why we're
chairs.
Using... why we use the same group of people?
Yeah, basically, table tipping, again, is another form of communication. And... essentially what should happen is that once communication is made with the spirit, the table should start moving, and you can use the movement of the table backwards and forwards or rapping sounds on the table to communicate, to get yes-no answers
okay.
To questions. Where again, we're using the same people because there's a lot in the literature, a lot in the research that shows you need to have a group of people comfortable with each other, relaxed, also even making jokes.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
You know, to get that sort of activity.
All right.
Yeah.
Well, I do know we've got David Wells, and we've also got our audience member Nicole. Do you want to come? Do you want to come close to the table? Because if anything does happen, then you'll be able to sort of see. Could you stand
right.
Towards the back of
yeah.
Us there?
Yeah. Stand over.
You're all right, Nicole.
Oh yes, fine, thank you.
Okay. All right, are you a believer, Nicole?
I am, yes.
Okay. Well, if anything, we've all experienced drops in temperature here.
Right.
And David, if you start picking anything up, please just say so. Please start. Okay.
Okay.
All right, then. Should we start off by touching fingertips just to get
yeah.
The energy
yeah.
Going? Okay. Please, if there is anybody here in this room with us now, please use our collective energy. We don't mean you any harm at all. Please come forward. Please come forward and use our energy. Come forward and try and use this table as a way of communicating with us. If you can hear my voice, please try so hard. Please try and move this table as a way of communicating with us now. Jeffrey, if you can hear my voice, please, I'm asking you one last time, please come forward. And Ian, if you can hear my voice too, or any other spirits that are here in this room with us now, we would like to talk to you. We mean you no harm. Please could you try and move this table now? Please could you try? With your fingertips to the edge of the table, very lightly. Please try and move this table if there is anybody here in this room with us now. Please come forward. Please move the table as a sign of yes if you would like to talk to us. Please try and move it. If there is anybody here, any spirit person here that would like to talk to us, then please move this table now. Is there anybody here? Are there any spirit people here in this room now? If there is, please try and move this table. Okay, please try and move this table now. Okay. I felt a slight movement there.
I did
it. You
yeah,
did?
Just slight, yeah.
Okay.
I know we're going to go to a break now, but join us after the break, because the table is starting to move. Join us after the break. Tapped on the table then. Who tapped?
Well, welcome back to this, the first of three nights of Most Haunted Live. So much has happened tonight. Let's go straight back to the sergeant's quarters where the team are continuing their investigation.
Are you here in the room with us now? Please try hard. Hello? Yes. Are you on your own? You are on your own. Did you die in 1942? Did you die in 1943? You did die in 1943. And you died from a training exercise. Could you make this movement? Could you please move the table more, please? Did you die in a training exercise? You did.
Yvette?
Yes?
Can I ask her if he's got a slightly displaced jaw
for me? Do you have a slightly displaced jaw? Is there a disfigurement to your face in any way? No. Okay. Any other questions? Do you want us to be here? Are you still with us? You do? Okay. Just so everybody knows at home, during the break, this table has started to move. We've asked various questions. And a gentleman has come through. The table has been rocking. I don't know if you can see it. Okay. Is your name Geoffrey? Is your name Ian? Hello, Ian. Ian, were you born in this country? You were born in this country. And you died in 1942. Did you have a wife? You did have a wife. Did you have children? Could you make that move? Could you move the table harder for us, please, Ian? Please move the table for us harder.
Please.
Please try harder. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Fingertips on the edge.
Fingertips on the edge. Were you here earlier, Ian? Were you here? You were. Could you just hear my voice? You could. Would you like us to stay here for a few more nights? Okay. Do you want to move on, Ian? Do you want to go to the light? That wasn't quite... If you want to move to the light, please make the movement much stronger. Do you wish to leave this place, Ian, and go to the light? Stronger, Ian. Do you want to go to the light? Please let us know. We can help you. Do you wish to stay here? Do you wish to stay here? Are you still with us, Ian? Ian, please move the table if you're still here. Please don't leave us now. Please come forward. Please move the table some more. Please give us a sign. Are you still with us, Ian? Please move the table some more. We respect you, we don't mean you any harm, we're not making a fool of you, this is not a game, this is our way of trying to communicate with you. Ian, can you hear me? Ian, please don't leave us. Please give us one last sign, please move the table again. Yes, thank you, Ian, thank you. This is great. I don't know if everybody at home can actually see that the table has moved, it is rocking. There you go. Ian, were you responsible for making the temperature in here go icy cold before?
Okay.
Did you make the bang on the roof, Ian? Was it you? Will you do anything else to show us that you're here, Ian? Do you like to play games? Were you a bit of a prankster when you were here? Did you have many friends here, Ian? Are your friends in spirit? Do you see them? Do you see other spirits here in this room with you? You do. Would you like us to leave now, Ian? Would you like us to stay? Ian, are you still there? Ian, are you still there? You are. It's going. David, are you picking up on anything now?
I'm still getting it. It's not either scene. I'm still getting some of it. It's like the jaw is slightly displaced. They're making my jaw go to one side. I don't think it is Ian. I think it's someone here else who's here.
Is there anybody else here in this room with us now that is not Ian that would like to talk to us? Is there anybody else in this room with us now? Please come forward. Is there anybody else here in this room with us now? Please make this table move if there is. Please come forward. Is there anybody else in this room with us now? I think it's gone weak. I think it's gone weak now.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, well, we're going to leave this room now, I think, and I think maybe we'll make our way back to the studio, if that's okay. I mean, I think that was, we felt it.
It was
yeah.
Very, very
I don't
strong.
Know if anybody, yeah. if you guys Harry. In the studio could hear the table
Absolutely.
Moving, David.
Okay, Yvette, thank you. And what amazing stuff that table tilting words. Is. Yeah. Amazing stuff. If you're watching at home, I bet you're on the edge of your sofa like I am. Now, I have to tell you, we've got some more unexpected news tonight. Amazing night. Jamie Pringle's come back. Jamie, what is the result of your radar examination?
We've looked at two areas, acquired various bits of data, and we can tell in one particular area there's a profile showing definite changes from the background.
What does that mean in English?
Basically, there may be something there that's worth investigating.
Sorry, say that again.
Maybe worth investigating.
So there may be a chamber there from what you've seen tonight.
Indeed.
I think that is pretty impressive. So basically, Derek and it was David as well, and our audience at home have located a possible chamber which you may have found on that radar. That is fantastic news. Ladies and gentlemen, it seems we may well indeed have a chamber. How fantastic. Thank you for that, Jamie. That's brilliant news. Round of applause for that. Thank you. Very quickly, Richard Jones and Richard Felix, summarise tonight for us. How well do you think we've done tonight?
We've done remarkably well tonight. We've had some extremely good paranormal phenomena taking place. And, of course, that table tilting at the end. I've been doing it recently. We do not fake it. It is genuine. It's fascinating.
I can only back that up. It's been a fascinating evening and a lot's come out of it.
It certainly has. I have to say, you know, for the first night, sometimes they're a little slow tonight. It's been fantastic.
It's been wonderful.
Thank you very much indeed. Julian, have you got an update for us?
Yeah, well, it's another incredible night. Lots of response. 13,000 web sightings tonight. And the most popular camera this evening, by the way, was the Road to Shell Island. So that was the one that you saw the most things on. Many sightings of orbs, flashing lights. Hundreds of viewers have had similar stories here of a dark figure of a man in uniform, voices and sounds of footsteps. So a great night, and we're going to do it all again, of course, tomorrow. David, back to you.
Thank you very much indeed. Well, it's that time of the night that I'm delighted to say, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome them back. Yvette Fielding, Derek Cora and Kieran O'Keefe. Moses, I mean, honestly, what an amazing first night. I know you've been out there in the cold all night. Have a look at some of tonight's extraordinary moments.
Cold. I can hear you. Look at me.
It is so cold.
Okay. I can't get it through.
Oh, sorry. Do something else.
I've got a name. Come on.
What was that?
Did you hear that? That sounds like a footstep.
Yeah? Did you hear that? Anybody else hear
yes,
it?
It's wrong. Whoever the
you're getting angry. You're getting angry.
I get these feelings. It's like as if I just want to go.
If I can't do it anymore, I'm going to have to leave. I'm so sorry.
Did anybody else hear it? You did,
you know what it was like? It was. It was a chair being just...
Wow, fantastic stuff. What are your thoughts so far about tonight, Yvette? Because, you know, all this stuff that's come out, you know, Derek came up with Ian, the squadron leader, that the boys didn't come back, the psychic artist came up with his checkers back in Pilot, I mean, so much stuff.
So much has happened. I'm so excited now. I mean, let's move on to tomorrow night. It's just amazing. We've just come back from the same room. The table was moving. People absolutely have experienced things. Noises, footsteps. It's been absolutely brilliant. Thoroughly enjoyed ourselves.
But also, I was amazed that so much happened so early on tonight with that seance. Derek, what was that like for you?
It was absolutely fantastic. You know, there was an expectancy like never before. And it was like we just couldn't wait to get started. And suddenly, bang, it started happening. It was our wishes, you know.
Yeah, it was great.
They were responding.
It absolutely was. So tonight was brilliant. What would you expect from tomorrow night?
It could be the pinnacle of all. You know, should we not go to bed and start it again now?
Yeah.
You know, I should keep up with it, you know.
I know the audience here have been absolutely gripped by what's been going on. And the fact is, Derek, you know, whether or not people believe you, you have come up with the names. Our historians have actually said that the names were great, and they were right.
So those spirit people were there.
Congratulations to you tonight. And congratulations. It has been amazing. So a very big thank you to everyone. Thank you to Julian and his interactive team. Thank you also to the historians, to Richard Jones and Richard Felix. Also to our experts, David Wilson and Paul Fleury-Sava, Kieran O'Keefe, Derek Acora and Yvette Fielding. And of course, you, the audience. It's been an amazing night. Be sure you join us tomorrow. We'll be visiting the most terrifying part, the morgue. So much coming up. We'll see you tomorrow at 9 o'clock.